Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome in the name of Jesus. A few people, you guys came back. That's good. Hey, I got a couple things I want to announce to you before we go with worship here. I want to introduce you. I have two sisters. They're much older than me. And it's really weird. They're both married to Missouri Synod Lutheran pastors. And I have both of them here today. And Gail and Jeff Lee, Jeff works with me at the Minnesota North District. There's no nepotism involved, but we work together. And right there, raise your hand. There, this is us. That's them. You know, everybody knows Pastor Lee probably. And my much older sister, Colleen, and Thomas Brown. Thomas Colleen Brown. He's a pastor, and she works also as a DCE at Ascension Lutheran Church in Tucson, Arizona. And so they just moved there about a year ago, and they come up because I have an 88-year-old father in Fulda, and they come up to see family, and they just, that's a great way of just being able to fly up. And so Tom is also a really very good pastor. He's a church planting extraordinaire. He's amazing what he does. And Jeff, well, Jeff is Jeff, you know. No. Yeah, Jeff, we're really blessed. And I know that you guys are leaving right after church, right? Because you got a plane flight to catch up one or something like that. So raise your hand and let everybody know. So that's them. So. Yeah, they've planted or restarted several churches. Jeff runs the district. I don't know if you know that. If you need to know anything about the district, you talk to Jeff because he knows everything. A couple of the things. We were going to do Welcome to the Family Sunday at the end of April, and I just realized I was so excited about all these families joining. I got to do all these transfers and get all this stuff done. I'm going to move it back into May just because I got all these things that I need to take care of. So, and Nadine says, Mom, you can think about these things before you get so excited. So I want to move that back. I do say one thing. May 2nd, we're going to have God bless our summer Sunday. And what I need is, I need a boat. I need an RV. I need a side-by-side or a four-wheeler. Things like that that we would do in the summer. And I want to put them right out on that grass right out front here. And I also need someone who will grill some hot dogs up and maybe be able to get some fixings for s'mores. Because we're going to, after church, we're going to have some hot dogs if we want. If you want to have, what a great brunch, huh? Hot dogs and s'mores. But we're going to ask God to bless our summer because, and I think of my brother-in-law and sister, Tom McLean, people from Tucson are leaving Tucson to come up back here. Well, and this is our time. And everybody knows people who comes up to visit, to be in the Pequot Lakes area, to go fish and ski and to do all the things. And we're going to ask God that he would bless the summer and that he would use us to make a difference in their lives. Just think of one, we could just invite them to worship with us, just so that they could hear about Jesus. So that's kind of what, that's going to be May 2nd. If you want to volunteer by bringing your watercraft or your RV or whatever, we probably have room for three or four of them on there. On a boat.
Can I bring a horse?
You know what? You can. If you control it, you get the shovel along too, brother. Okay? Yeah. So, and then I'm going to need somebody that's going to be able to do a little bit of, kind of got out a little early, we should grill the good brats that you had on the wiener wagon there so that we get whatever brats those were. And we can have those. It'll be fun. And we're not going to stay out there forever after church, but it's going to be something we can do together. Okay, that's it. Why don't we stand up, turn to our neighbor, let's give everybody a really good welcome, and then we'll start with our first hymn. Examine our lives, confess our sins to God, and to seek his forgiveness and strength. We confess.
God, forgive our sin and create a new heart that lives in the power and freedom of your forgiveness.
Know this, you have been set free from sin by the suffering, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Your sins are forgiven completely. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest, and we have seen it and testified to it and proclaimed to you the eternal life which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you. So that you too may have fellowship with us, and indeed our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and to him there is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not only for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel according to John, and this is what I'll be preaching on this morning. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of anyone, they are forgiven. If you withhold the forgiveness from anyone, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the marks of his nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, and see my hands, and put out your hand, and place it into my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing in him, you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated.
Prison. He opened its prison.
Children or my grandchildren? Why are we here? I submit to you today that mercy and grace is what we do. And I'm not trying to make us feel bad by this, but I think that a lot of times the institutional church kind of loses this focus a little bit, that we get so worried about preserving what we have here and all the little things that we do, that a lot of times we miss the primary mission, which is to go out and bring mercy and grace to people that we know and people in our homes, and to extend it to everybody that we know that needs to know the grace and mercy that is in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Flip the page. Let's talk about the disciples, because this whole thing, Jesus is now transitioning his disciples kind of post-resurrection into this whole idea. He's kind of expanding their idea of what this is all about. What are we going to do? Because you've got to remember, a lot of the disciples, even at the last minute, thought that the Messiah was going to be one that was going to give them back their land, right, from the Romans, and that was going to restore Israel's promise, our prominence in the area. And remember, Jesus says, his kingdom is not of this world. That he's more the king of our heart, of our souls, and not just a land mass. So as he rises from the dead and they see him, that he's starting to kind of expand this, to help them understand this. And it's really interesting today. The disciples, flip down the first one here. They were still coming to grips with what happened and were afraid. Can you imagine what it would have been like? The chief priests, this whole Sanhedrin, that whole leadership, and all those other leaders were scared of what Rome would do if there was an insurrectionist that was saying that he's the king of the Jews. And so that's kind of why Jesus got killed, among other reasons, They didn't want to mess up what they already had, so they killed Jesus, and they were going to not only to stomp on the head of the snake, they were going to kill the rest of the body. And so I think that the disciples were rightly afraid. They were hiding in a room with the door locked, because as much as they believed in Jesus as Savior and they saw the resurrection of the dead, they still were a little concerned. Because you remember, some of them had already yet seen him, and yet they were that scared. Can you imagine how frightening it would be to think that your life is in danger? But you still saw him alive, but still, I don't know. So they were still coming to grips with what happened, and they were afraid. Go one more now. Jesus' appearance on verse reassured them. Now, this is what's really interesting here. Now, I'm going to read this to you. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." They showed him his hands and feet. Now, you know, he didn't have a lockpick. You know, he didn't go up there and do, 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 you know, Mission Impossible. He appeared. He was there. I mean, this is, can you imagine? It's like, beam me up, Scotty, but this is not no beaming technology. Just boom. He is in there. All of a sudden, he's there. And he shows him his hands and feet and his side. He had a wound in his side from the spear. He appeared to them with the door locked. He showed them his hands and his side and flip it down. He sent them out with a message. And here's what the message is. Next one. Read it with me.
Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you.
And then he said this again to them. After he said this, he said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of anyone, they are forgiven. If you withhold the sins from anyone, it is withheld." Think about what it means. He says, "Peace I leave with you. Peace be with you." What is peace? You know, we have peace between Canada and the United States, right? We don't go into war. We're not looking for war. The peace that we have from God is a peace that we have with the Father, that he no longer looks at our sins. He no longer looks at the wrong things that we have done. He sees only the Father, only sees the blood of his Son, Jesus, who washes away all of our sins. When the Father looks at us, all he sees is the blood of his Son, Jesus Christ. And that is for you. Now I know that if you're like me, it's easy for us to dump all those little sins that we think are little, but those ones that haunt our brains, those ones that alter the way we live and alter the way we think, I want you to know that Jesus paid for that too, every single one of them. You are forgiven, not because you're such a righteous person, but because we have peace with the Father through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So that peace comes like this, from the Father through his Son into us. And then the peace that we have spreads out to everyone else. Because now I have peace with God. It changes the way I look at the world, the way I look at my family, the way I look at those who sin against me or those who I've sinned against. That peace, that Bible says, that passes all human understanding, right? It guards our hearts and our minds through faith in Christ Jesus. That's what that's talking about. That peace that passes all understanding. That's why lives are changed. It doesn't mean that we're all of a sudden perfect and holier than thou, but our lives are changed by the peace that we have through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And that's the peace that Jesus is saying, "Peace, I'm going to give to you. Peace be with you." And as the Father has sent me, he's sending us to bring that peace, that forgiveness of sins, out to the area that we live in, to all the world. Now, there are some people in our church body who will say that he only gave this mandate to the pastors. And I'm telling you today that that's baloney, He gave that mandate to all of us, to send all of us, to bring forgiveness of sins, to bring peace to all the people that we know and love who need this. How many of you know someone in your life that really could use this peace from God right now? Raise your hand. We all do. And if you don't, and I get that, you can come and talk to me or to Pastor Johnson, and we would help you. And that wouldn't even be saying, see, I told you. It would just be sometimes you need memory things to kind of figure out, oh, I know that person, and they either don't go to church, or they don't, they're going through tough times, or they don't know Jesus as Savior. Maybe they could use that peace too. So we see how God was descending, or how Jesus was sending the disciples out. What about you? Flip the page. Where's God sending you? This way, that way, the other way. Number one. Hit it once. God is sending you here, where we make a difference. The Pequot Lakes area. Or wherever you live. Do you live in town? Your neighbors? Where you work? Your friends? The people that maybe deliver your mail or your Amazon packages. The person that is remodeling your house or fixing your car. That's where God wants you right there, to deliver that peace. Remember how we always talk about it? We believe that God will give us opportunity. We always say the Bible says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will what? Knock and the what? Door will be open. So we always pray, Lord, give me an opportunity to let someone hear the peace that God has given to us. And he will give it to us. It happens all the time. And it really does. God is calling you right here. You know, and it's kind of funny, in the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, for such a long time, we have thought that bringing peace, the peace of God, the forgiveness of sins, is to go to other continents. And that's important that we do that. We did that well. But I sometimes think that we did this because we like to throw money at things that we don't want to do. And I'm here to tell you that right now in Pequot Lakes, in the state of Minnesota, in the nation of the United States of America, that Christianity is now a minority religion. Do you realize that less than half of people go to church anymore in America? That just came out. Less than half. So the point of all this is there's a whole bunch of people around us that just need to know the peace of God that passes all human understanding. To needs to know that Jesus is their Savior and Lord. And especially with what we're going through right now in this world, right? That people could just really use a little hope in their lives. Flip it down. Where's God sending you? To home, where we live. And everybody asks me, what can I do? Because everybody's upset with what's going on in the nation. And there's things that we just seem that we can't control. If you ever felt that way, you just can't control. Your vote doesn't seem to matter. And that's kind of goofy. The leadership, that they don't seem to have our best in mind, no matter where they are. But one thing you can do to make a difference is to start in your homes. With your children, with your grandchildren, with your relatives, or whoever that may be, that God is sending you with the gospel to there. And this is where I think things have to change for us as a congregation. A lot of times we expect the church to be the surrogate Christian for all of us, for our kids and for our grandkids and for us. They're the one, and there's going to be some, how we do these things in the future, we're going to be doing more of equipping you so that you can bring this forgiveness of sins to your home. It's not that we're going to all of a sudden take away our own duties, but we want to equip and disciple you so that you can, by virtue of who you are as a parent or grandparent or whoever that may be, an influencer in your home, in your family, that you can deliver and be comfortable with delivering that good news that Jesus Christ is Savior and Lord. Where is God sending you? One more. Read it with me.
To the house of peace.
I think that you need this. I know that you need this. That a lot of you today are living with a lot of turmoil in your life, either seen by everybody else or unseen. And I know that there's not a lot of hope in some of the things that are going on. We turn off the TV because we don't know, we can't make hide our hair of what's going on there. But I want you to know that God is sending peace to you. This is not just more busy work for us to do. That there might be parts of your life where you need to know that God loves and forgives you, that yeah, you may have really blown it bad, but you lay it at the foot of the cross, and in Christ you are forgiven, and you are set free, and like I said last week, today is a what?
New day.
See, you guys were listening. Isn't that great? Today is a new day. And that's where that peace comes from. That peace that we have, peace from above, from our Father, through His Son, Jesus Christ, that peace that filters out into our hearts and our minds through faith in Christ Jesus, and that flows out to everyone else. Okay, last one. This is the last one, I promise. We'll be wrapping up here real quick. So what if we're not cut out for this? Good gravy, Pastor. Why are you asking me to do things that I don't know how to do? This is your job. Okay, you complain. Number one. Name one disciple that was cut out to do this. What did Peter do during all of this? What did Peter do during all this a trial and of Jesus? What did he do? He denied. Thomas, in our gospel today, he wouldn't even believe unless he saw what? Well, yeah, the nail holes and the spear. He said, stop doubting and believe. 8 days after Jesus appeared to them for the first time, what were the disciples still doing? They were hiding in a locked room. I mean, he went, I'm here, peace be with you, brother, I'm going to send you out. 8 days later, they're still in the locked room. Because it was all so unbelievable. My point of all this is that the disciples weren't superheroes. Next. Remember those who messed up and how Jesus dealt with them. Jesus didn't condemn Thomas. Matter of fact, and Thomas wasn't always just that way. Remember when Jesus was sent to go to Jerusalem, all the disciples were telling him, don't go there. Thomas said, let's go and we'll go die with him. I mean, we all have good days and we all have bad days. Later on in the Gospel of John here, Jesus absolves Peter and says, I'm going to build my church on you. And he says he wants him to go feed his sheep. Next. What does this say to you? What does it say to you? God uses you. He loves you. He forgives you. He is sending you. If you go talk to someone about Jesus and you want to share with them the peace of God that passes all human understanding, what is the worst thing they can say to you? No. So don't cry about it. Go to the next person and pray for their hearts to be open and come back to them someday. We don't know how God is going to work. Who'd have ever thought that the traditionally worst Sunday of this church year is the Sunday after Easter for attendance? Look around. Just turn around and look. Look at everybody here today. Who would have ever thought that was going to happen? Who would have ever thought that would happen? We don't know how God is going to work in a person's life, but we know that He does work through us. As we share the love that God has for us in Jesus Christ, as we bask in His peace that passes all understanding. You know what? I'm out of things to say. That's enough for today. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's sing our next song, and then as we do that, we'll take our offering. Well, they'll bring the offering plates up. Thank you.
Bryson-Berg's son. Bryson is in our confirmation. Cassandra yesterday was killed in an ATV accident.
Oh.
Yeah, and so, and I had my phone shut. Pastor Johnson got the phone call, and he's dealing with it right now. I know that a lot of families go to the bishop across there. But Cassandra came here, and I think especially when we had the 11 o'clock service, she was here. And so she died tragically. There's three children. There's Bryson, who's in our confirmation class, and then there's Braxton. And I can't recall, does anybody know the name of the fourth grade daughter?
Brooklyn.
Okay, very good. I know it was a B then, but I couldn't remember who it was. So we want to pray, because Pastor Johnson is on it, and he's working. He's preaching in Frazee, I think, today. But he is on this, and he's going to do a really good job. And so that funeral probably, I think it's going to be here, or at least he's going to be doing it. And so we want to remember Bryson and Braxton and Brooklyn and all this all Cassandra's family. Please rise up there. Gracious Lord, the power of your love and your mercy, your grace, your peace, it changes us forever. We are so thankful that you defeated sin, death, and the power of the devil for us. That you rose again from the dead on the third day to give us the forgiveness of sins and the promise of eternal life. Lord, we pray that you would reach within our hearts where we are hurting and bring that peace to our lives. And Lord, open our hearts to all those around us in this area, especially in Pequot Lakes area, who need to hear of this peace that passes all human understanding. Use us, Lord, as you see fit. Lord, we pray for the family of Cassandra Berg, especially for her children, Bryson, Braxton, and Brooke. Lord, we pray that they would be with these children and all their family that mourn her death. Lord, we pray that you would be with them, that you would give to them the hope of the resurrection to eternal life for all who trust in you, and that you would use us to reach into this family's lives as you see fit to bring them some peace. Lord, we lift it before you, Kaylee Rousen, who is continuing to recover from cancer surgery. And Lord, we're so thankful that she's among us. And Lord, we pray that you continue to be with her. And for Janine Coffey's brother, David, who continues to be in and out of the hospital. Lord, we pray that you bring healing and strength upon both these brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, we're very grateful for all you've done at Glory Day. What a blessing, Lord. What response, Lord, to your gospel. We're so thankful. Lord, use us as you see fit, Lord, to bring this powerful message to the area around us. All these things, Lord, we bring to you. Pray and pray you taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Let's sing our last hymn. Forgiveness. All right? God be with you.